Today's video is a 1 year tour of my Prusa XL kit two head 3D printer. My name is Matthew Barrett. Welcome to Barrett Works. The printer arrived in early December 2024. And for those of you paying attention, that means it's really 1 year and 3 months, but I'm a bit behind. I'm not going to be doing a review of the Prusa. There have been plenty of those, but I will say that my experience of this printer has been very good. I've had one failure of a stepper motor early on, which Prusa support quickly helped me diagnose, sent me a new motor, and the quality of the prints have been pretty darn good. It lives over here in the printer closet, and the closet itself is something that I will do some videos about later. It's a very small space with a lot of technology packed into it, or a lot of kind of systems. Obviously and visibly are all of the filament dry boxes, an e-dry cabinet, that is the initial drying, and my printer is set up so that there is a holster for those dry boxes, and all my printing happens with fully dried filament from inside the dried boxes. The printer itself has had many things done to it. Quite a few are kind of standard mods from the community, printables.com and other places. Others are things that I have come up with myself. Some of the things from the community I've modified. What I'm going to do is give you a brief overview of everything that I've done that is custom or unique enough that I think it's worth pointing out, or that plays a significant role in making this printer work well for me in this space. The kinds of things that are a part of this are a fully enclosed printer, active heating with temperature control, exhaust to the outside, the ability to use the printer either in the closet or out in the room, a dozen or more other things. So I'm going to move the printer out of the closet, hook it up as it would be if it was being used out in the room, and then I'll give you an overview of all of the places where there are significant or unique or very functional modifications that have been done to this printer. Okay, this is the Prusa in all its glory out of the closet. I've opened the enclosure so that I can show you inside more easily. And the table, it has wings, wooden shelves that fold out. And so I've raised the wing on the right side so that I can show you the heater that's installed more easily. It's an AC Infinity T3 ThermoForge designed for grow tents. Okay, so since we're on the side of the printer, let's start here. I've installed magnets on the 3030 aluminum extrusion that's in the front corner. What 3030 aluminum extrusion, you say? Because the Prusa XL doesn't have an extrusion here in this front corner. Mine does on both sides. And so that's one of the modifications I did to give myself structural mounting points. I didn't think it was a harm to make this whole structure a bit more rigid, but primarily I wanted to have the ability to have hard anchor points here and on the other side in particular where I have the filament dry boxes. As long as I had them, I went ahead and took magnets, threaded them into T-nuts. And so the tools that I use as I print actively attach with magnets. So I just grab them. The pointy tools go into this fine nylon mat, but it's 3 inches deep. And it's designed to allow you to put tools in that are pointy enough to kind of press in and hold themselves. The hanging rail for nozzles is a modification of a design from Printables. I've used the version that has the opening expecting there to be a silicone sock. So all of my hot ends, I've got silicone socks on. Some of these nozzles are obsidian nozzles, regular obsidian nozzles. Some are high flow. That becomes important later when I show you the nozzle brushes that I've used. And a difficulty that occurred because these nozzles are a little bit over 2 millimeters longer than the non-high flows. This is the duct for the active heater. I've used off-the-shelf video camera equipment articulated arms. They're not terribly expensive. And this again is threaded into a roll-in T-nut here in the aluminum extrusion. Instead of printing some kind of arm, which then has one position or coming up with joints, I bought this and I can mount whatever I want on the end of it. And just using these unlocks, these joints move on multiple directions, and I can control the camera placement without printing new parts, without any trouble. I have two cameras mounted because I had a regular Wi-Fi camera, a indoor security camera, Eufy, installed. I've used that with printers for ages. This is Prusa's new buddy cam. I may switch entirely to the buddy cam once and if they get the live video rolled out. For now, I just printed this extender bar and they're both sitting back here looking through the same window. At this point, I'm not sure which I will end up keeping or if they will continue to both be used. I did the buddy board cooling modification. So this is the fan up top. I went ahead and gave it two intakes, two openings. When the printer is on, as you can hear, there's a bit of fan noise all the time, and these boards stay cool. And I just quit worrying about and thinking about how hot they were getting. The feet on this printer have been extended, and I've added extra feet in the back. It is up an extra 2 inches, perhaps, from what a standard is, in order for me to install underneath my flex plate holding system. The other thing that's interesting here about the back is it looks like my cart has a tail. That's the power cord. But it's a power cord going into an automatic retracting extension cord reel. So when I pull this printer out of the closet in the middle of a print, because I realized it's going to run longer than I thought and I need it to be in the room instead of in the closet as it finishes, I do that while it's printing. And it remains plugged into the wall and extends. Now, you could do that pulling it out of the closet fairly easily. Rolling it back is hard. So, because this automatically retracts, once it's released and it's pulling, I can roll the cart back into the closet without the wheels rolling over the cord. Okay, the exhaust system. It's my own creation inspired by designs that are out there, and I'm going to be doing a lot more about that later. And so that runs into a port in the wall and into the closet, where there's a big ball valve, because at times when the printer's in here, this hose is what's connected to the top of it. And at times it's out in the room, and so this valve is turned to control the air pulled from the fan, an AC infinity fan, a 4-inch fan, and then out through the attic and the roof. You may notice that there's a panel back here where Prusa has, and you can just see peeking out, they have kind of a mesh grid. I have a panel that is held in place with magnets and then has ports for the wires to go through. If I was going to be enclosing this, and when I was originally passively heating it, I didn't want that big vent on the back. I believe that was going to be fine, and it's now been well over a year that it's been like this and I have not had any troubles. Now that I have an active heater, I probably don't need that. I could let that be a place where heat gets dumped, if not accidentally, for no good purpose. But I've left it because I've not had any operational problems. You may notice my filament sensor wire is just hanging here. That's because I do not use, as quite a few people in the community don't, I do not use the external filament sensor. I got rid of it. It was a pain in the ass. And the reason it was a pain was because it was hard at times to get filament to go through it. It was a point at which drag was created on the filament. And I don't want the printer to sense that it's run out of filament here, stranding a very long length of filament in the Bowden tube. I want that to happen at the printhead, at the second filament sensor. That's where the filament end is when it recognizes it's out of filament. If I'm doing an auto join and it's switching to the other printhead, great, I've wasted almost nothing. If I'm actually needing to go in and swap it during that print, I just pull the Bowden tube from the top of the hot end and retrieve that little bit of filament. So this has been a wonderful change. These are my own custom fittings, regular PTFE fittings here, And then these are something I designed for my dry boxes. You can kind of see one in there. And it just makes it easier to insert the filament. It's got a little bit of a cone here at the end. And so when you're trying to get filament in, and if this printer is in the closet, I'm reaching in along the side of it, I can feed the filament in pretty easily. Which brings us to the dry boxes. So these are two dry boxes in their holsters. I wouldn't normally have filament there if I wasn't printing, but I put them in so that you could see. And I have, as you've probably noticed in the background and I mentioned earlier, all of my filament that's ready for use are in dry boxes. And when they're being used, they just go there. Now I can feed extruder from either position, but I generally use this for extruder one and this for extruder two. If and when I've got a roll of filament that's for some reason not in a box, and I just need to do this, I can hang them on the Prusa original spool holder. And so every once in a while, I make use of that. Another wing on the table. And obviously I designed this table with wheels. It's narrow at the top so I could have these folding arms, but still get it through doors. Down below, it's as wide as it can be for stability and still make it through the doors. So inside, I have installed one of the community's designs, something else from Printables again, nozzle brushes. But if you look closely, you'll notice that the center row, actually I think there's four rows, so one of the central rows, has been torn out in each of these. They were in great shape until I switched to the high flow nozzles. The high flow nozzles are 2 millimeters or so longer, and while the Z height of the bed adjusts automatically based on probing, and therefore it works perfectly with whatever length nozzle it happens to find, this is all got kind of fixed relationships. When the printhead's going back into the dock, it's at a fixed height. It's going to be the same height no matter what to fit onto the mounting. And the high flow nozzle sticks down 2 millimeters further and has torn all these silicone bristles out of these brushes. So I'm going to lower them and as low as they can be where they still touch traditional nozzles, and also engage with the high flow without tearing out. And of course, there's one here in the front that it uses just before probing. So when it's printing, it wipes the nozzle just before it does the probing. The sensor for the active heating, humidity and temperature. The little window I had to cut in the insulation. Yes, insulation. So this is the enclosure from Printables. Though I went ahead and ordered the kit that the creator of this enclosure had available. And so what I received were the plexiglass panels and hardware and then printed all of the plastic parts. I have modified the upper piece to have a hole for my vent. And I've also got, and you can just barely see it, the end of the Bowden tube that is my fitting for when I'm printing flexibles. I don't ever print two flexibles at the same time, so I only have one entry here in the top. When the printer is in the closet, I just go ahead and put the flexibles on the shelves that are kind of above the printer and can feed them in there. I might at some point add a second port up here. Maybe at some point I'd even end up with five if I upgrade this. Yes, that is a smoke detector. Yes, it is in a crazy position for a printer that is, in a sense, sealed and evacuates to the outside. So, like in a chemistry lab, it's got a hood. So, if there were smoke in here, which we even tested when I first created this setup, put the enclosure on, even without the lower doors, and burned incense in here, not a hint of the smell in the room, with a light flow through this, what in a sense is a hood. It's the only location I found for the smoke detector at this point. Obviously, if things were really going wrong and there was a real fire going, I'm pretty sure it would go off. But at some point, I need to find a better place. The controller for the active heating system is here on the right. And designed for grow tents, it means that it monitors temperature, humidity, and then can be set to cycle on automatically. It's set currently to run the fan when it gets up to 26 degrees. You can see it's 24 degrees Celsius. So the printer's not running. And the heater is set to off. So this one controller controls both the fan that's in the closet and it controls the heater, both from the same company, both from AC Infinity. When you've got that remote controller, the control panel down here remains blank, and this is where you control it. Actually, I control it from my phone, so I rarely am interacting with this panel directly. And I can set the temperature to anything I want, up to 60 degrees Celsius. The heater cycles on and off automatically, and it works extremely well. I have not yet installed all of the polycarbonate replacement parts inside, so I've been limiting it to 40 degrees so far. Once I get the polycarbonate replacements installed in the printheads, I'm going to do all the replacements that would come on a printer. Then I'm going to go ahead and dig into some of the materials I haven't yet that require the higher temperatures. So that was the 1 year plus a few months summary video of my Prusa XL. I didn't provide details about the various modifications that I highlighted. That's coming next. There will be a whole set of shorter videos, each one focusing on one area of the printer, one modification, one change I've made to the way this printer's set up or the way I use it. The intention is to provide enough detail so that if it's something that you think you might like to do to your XL or to another printer you have, you'll have enough information to get started, including, when appropriate, 3D files loaded up to printables.com that you can download to print. The modifications that I've done to this printer and the things that I design and print in general are not cosmetic. They are always focused on function. For me, this is like the beginnings of a world in which we have our own personal replicator. Think of Star Trek. In Star Trek, you could just walk up to it, tell it what you wanted, and out it came, miraculously accurate. We're not there yet, of course. So when I realize that I need a part and design it in my head, something breaks, I need to replace it, whatever leads me to knowing that I need to create a 3D object, I have to sit down at my computer and design it in CAD. I use Shaper 3D, which I will do some content about later. Anyway, and then once that's done, I send it to the printer, and it prints, and there it is. But that vision, like when I needed a mount for this hand vacuum, when I could walk up to the printer, walk up to a replicator and say, I'd like a mount for this particular model of hand vacuum, and I would like it to attach magnetically, and I would like the vacuum to connect to it with one hand without having to fuss with it. And it comes up with the design and you can just print it and it prints very quickly, that's going to be extraordinary. We may be heading toward that. With AI, how long will it be before we can just define what we want by giving a prompt and a 3D design will be generated that's good enough to print and actually use? It may not be too long before 3D printers in homes begin to function like replicators. I'm looking forward to that. This is the first video that we've put up in the Barrett Works channel, so please subscribe, help us get this off the ground. As I said, there will quickly be a bunch more giving more details about this system, but there's a great deal of content that will be beyond the 3D printer in this particular workspace, particularly out in my woodshop, which is unusual for its size. It's tiny. The systems that I've built to allow me to do a great deal of work in that space, a surprising number of things, and a surprising capability in a space that small, with a great deal of efficiency, though working in a tiny space where you constantly have to switch out what tools are kind of in the active work area, is definitely slower than a full-size shop. But what I've built there is interesting, and I'm going to do quite a few videos to show it. There'll be videos about the work that's being done in the space, and videos about the system in the space. A lot of it centered around the central table, loaded with systems, called the Omni Table. You can decide later if you think that's an appropriate title for it. So, more videos coming about the details here as a starting point for 3D, videos from the shop, and many other things that relate to design and creation of tools and solutions in the shop, around the home, in making, even computer systems. Join us, and thanks for watching.